Life is like riding bicycle. To keep your balance, you must keep moving. With this sentence, we'll start today's lecture. First of all, welcome back to all of you in my lecture. Today, we are going to study about sliding contact bearing. It is also known as journal bearing, hydrodynamic bearing. Types of the sliding contact bearing are hydrodynamic bearing, sliding contact bearing. Here, we are only going to study about the hydrodynamic bearing, that is journal bearing. All of you know very well, or sliding bearing means one shaft, that is called a journal, here will be rotating inside the hub, okay, and there will be gap between the hub and the shaft, okay, and that gap will be filled by the film, some lubricant, okay. So here you can see in this three diagram has been shown here. So diagram A is showing when the shaft it is in stationary condition, then at that time the journal will be resting at the bottom, as you can see here in this diagram. When it starts rotating in clockwise direction, then journal will slightly move in this direction. It is the situation journal just starting to rotate. Now when it is in equilibrium, that time the position will be like this, and in this case this side part is called leading edge and this side part is called trailing edge, and this is happening due to the lubricant pressure inside. So that is only hydrodynamic pressure, it is developing inside the lubricant. So how pressure distribution is there inside the lubricant, you can see in this diagram. So up from here, this point to this point, completely there is no pressure, but from here the pressure starts and it is increasing continuously, and here the pressure it is maximum and then it is decreasing up to here zero. So this is the pressure distribution for a journal bearing, okay. Now if you classify the journal bearing, it is two types. One is full journal bearing, full bearing, and second is partial bearing. Full bearing means the journal is completely inside the bearing, okay, inside the hub. But in partial bearing, you can see some part of the hub has been placed and the journal is just resting on that, and the lubricant will be side flow. So that is the type of bearing, sliding contact bearing. Generally partial journal bearing, or you can also say partial contact bearing, it will be taken as 120 degree. The angle of contact, it is from this point to this point, we are taking this is as 120 degree. Generally, not every time, it may be 60 degree also, maybe 90 degree, maybe 180 degree. So it depends on the different application. According to the application we can take, okay. So now let us go to the nomenclature of the journal bearing. Here a typical diagram of a journal bearing has been shown. In this one you can identify O is the center of the journal, or you can say shaft, and O dash you can say that is the center of the hub, okay. In the running condition, the shaft or the journal is in this situation, it has been shown. This end is called the leading edge and this end is called trailing edge. It has been written here also. So this is the downside part, that is bearing. The line which is matching together centers of the shaft and the hub or hole is called the line of center. A load W is acting, W is the weight of the shaft or the load acting on the journal, or load acting on the shaft, you can say the radial load, because it is acting radially, isn't it? So W is the load acting. Here we will go one by one all this nomenclature and we will see in this diagram. So first of all it is capital D. So capital D you can see here, it has been marked from here this point to this point. This is the capital D and that is the journal diameter. In this we are going to take the journal diameter in centimeter. Okay. Next is C. C it is diametral clearance. So diametral clearance you can see in this diagram that here has been taken from this point to this point, that is D plus C, journal diameter plus the diametral clearance. You can calculate the diametral clearance, this distance minus the journal diameter D. So that is the diametral clearance capital C you will get. Next is H naught. You can see here H naught, minimum film thickness in centimeter. You can see this value here in this diagram. So here the thickness of the film is minimum, means the gap between the bearing and the journal is minimum, that is minimum film thickness, and it is denoted by H naught, and we can calculate it as C by 2, capital C by 2, it means the diameter clearance into 1 minus epsilon, where epsilon is the attitude. We will see next. Before attitude, we will see this E. E is eccentricity in centimeter. Eccentricity, you know very well, the distance from center. So here the distance from center means the distance from the center of the hub to the center of the shaft. So you can see the distance between O and O dash. So these two, the distance between these two has been shown is here, that is E. So that is the eccentricity of the bearing. Okay, you can calculate the eccentricity of the bearing as C by 2 minus H naught. Correct. Next is attitude. Attitude can be calculated as 2E by C, and that will be equal to 1 minus 2 H naught by C. That is attitude. Now next is H. Film, what is H? H is the film thickness at any angle theta, and we can calculate it as H equal to C by 2 epsilon cos theta plus 1. If you will substitute theta is equal to 0 degree, if you will substitute theta equal to 0 degree, means the angle we are taking from this one. So where theta is, if theta is equal to 0 degree, then it will be maximum, H will be maximum. Okay, means 1 plus epsilon cos theta is equal to 0 degree, means cos theta equal to 1. If theta equal to 0 degree, then epsilon plus 1. So H max you can get there. And now attitude angle. Attitude angle, how we'll calculate, that is denoted by phi. Attitude angle you can get from the vertical axis to the line where we are getting H max, that is the attitude in angle. L is the length of the bearing in centimeter. W, you have seen here, W is the load, it is in kgf we are taking here. P is the bearing pressure on projected area. Projected area means length is L and D is the diameter. So the projected area will be L into D. So how will calculate the bearing pressure? Load by area, we know that. So load is W, area is L into D. So the definitely bearing pressure will calculate W by L into D. Correct. Now after that N is the speed of journal in RPM. Okay, and N dash a speed of the journal in RPS, rotation per second. How we calculate? In RPM we'll divide by 60, we'll get RPS. And next is Z. Z is absolute viscosity of the oil in centipoise. Okay, so these are the nomenclature. Next we'll go to the some formulae which is useful for calculating some important data for journal bearing. Also you can say the design procedure also, one by one we'll see that. So let us see here. First is summer field number. It is denoted by S and it can be calculated as Z dash N dash by P into D plus C whole square. Here Z dash can be calculated as, so here Z dash is Z by 9.81 into 10 to power 7. N dash, the speed of the journal in RPS, rotation per second. P, bearing pressure. D by C is diameter clearance ratio, where D is the diameter of the journal and C is the diameter clearance. So we can calculate the summer field number. If L by D is equal to infinity, L is the length of the journal bearing and D is the diameter of the journal. So if the L by D ratio is infinity, then the summer field number value can be calculated as 2 plus epsilon square under root 1 minus epsilon square divided by 12 pi square epsilon, where you know that epsilon is the attitude. And how to calculate epsilon we have seen in last slide. After calculating the summer field number value, just check whether that S value is greater than 0.15 or less than 0.15. If it is greater than 0.15, then the coefficient of friction mu can be calculated as either using the Mickey's equation or using the Petrov's equation. So Mickey's equation tell that mu is equal to 33.25 divided by 10 to the power 10 into Zn by P into D by C plus K. For calculating these things, all you know that Z is absolute viscosity, Z, N, RPM, P, pressure, D, C, you know all these things. K, what is K? K is unknown here. So K you can calculate by using this graph. So here L by D ratio is given on this X axis. So calculate L by D ratio and just move upward direction. Let us say I am having L by D ratio 0.5. So I'll move just upward direction, where I will get this curve, that point, let us say I'm getting for 1.5 here. So we'll move horizontal direction, this direction. So there, whatever the value is crossing on this vertical axis, that is the K value. So here the K value is 0.005. So it means you can calculate for any L by D ratio, you can calculate K value from here, you can substitute here and you can calculate the coefficient of friction mu. Next, you can calculate mu value by using this formula also. Mu is equal to 2 pi square Z dash N dash by P into capital D by capital C. All the values are known to you, so you can calculate this mu. If summer field number is less than 0.15, then you can calculate mu is equal to C by D into 1 plus 2 epsilon square divided by 3 epsilon. Okay, so this is about the coefficient of friction. We will calculate heat generated, Hg, and we can calculate Hg by using this formula, mu into W into V. Mu, right now we have calculated coefficient of friction, W is the load and V is the velocity in meter per second, velocity of the journal or the surface. So it will be in meter per second we have to calculate. Then we will get Hg value in kgf meter per minute. Then you have to calculate the Hd value, heat dissipated. Heat generated, then heat dissipated. You can calculate heat dissipated by using formula delta T plus 18 whole square into LD divided by K. So delta T, change in temperature, length and diameter, you know that K is the constant, K is the constant, and you can select this K value from your data book. Two values are there, so I'll tell And see, all this formula I am writing from the data book. So this is in the PSG design data book. All the formula I have written from page number 7.34. And the K value has been given in the page number 7.35. Two values are given, 437 and 775. 437 is for heavy duty and 775 is for lightweight, light duty. Okay, so K value you can select from there and you can get the heat dissipated. So let us say if heat generated is more and heat dissipated is less, then what will happen? When it will heat more, it will slowly heat will increase inside that. So we have to take care about that. We have to extract that heat. We have to taken care, the heat should be taken out from there. So heat taken out by the extra cooling, artificial cooling, that I have written HT, and it can be calculated as HG minus HD, means heat generated minus heat dissipated. And because we are providing extra cooling, artificial cooling, so let us say mass of the extra providing cooling, artificial cooling is M. S is the specific heat of the liquid, T is the temperature within which the artificial cooling liquid is working. So HT can be calculated as MST. So HT already have calculated, HT value is known. If temperature and specific capacity, specific heat capacity of that liquid has been given, then we can calculate M value, means the mass, the quantity what we need per minute or per second, you can convert its unit. So here it is a complete description of the journal bearing. Okay, so now let us see how to design. We'll use only this formula for designing the journal bearing or just selecting the journal bearing. So first of all, what we'll do, according to the given data, we'll select L by D ratio, or we'll calculate L by D ratio. If L by L and D is available, then directly you can calculate L by D ratio. If it is not given, then L by D ratio you can select as per here. It is given in this table. Just a small part of the table I kept here. In table number 1, it is table number 1, page number 7.36 in PSG design data book. You will get this book in the exam also. So I request all of you, please follow this book for reference for designing for this subject or for solving any numerical in this subject. Okay, so from page number 7.36, you select this L by D ratio value. Okay, so values are given, first of all, in infinity, then 1, 0.5, 0.75, 0.5, 0.25, 4, 4, 5 values are given, 6 values are given. So according to that, we'll select the L by D ratio. Okay, after selecting the L by D ratio, we'll calculate L and D value. Out of these two, if maybe anyone will be given. If it that diameter is also not given, then you can assume the diameter value also. So after calculating the D and L, we'll go to the Summerfield number S. Okay, so Summerfield number S we'll calculate by using this formula. So first step was calculating the L and D value. Okay, in that only we'll calculate again pressure, P value. How we'll calculate P value? Load by area. Load is W, area is L into D. So project means P value we can calculate W by L into D. So we'll calculate the pressure we'll get from there. After calculating the pressure, we'll go to the Summerfield number, and Summerfield number we can calculate Z dash N dash by P into D into D by C whole square. So Z dash we can calculate by using this formula. N dash, you know, P, right now we have calculated W by L into D. D, it is known to you, C is known to you, so you can calculate Summerfield number. So after calculating Summerfield number, you can directly go to this table. Whatever L by D ratio you have selected, in that row you go and you select the S value in third column. Here in this column, S values are given, some values are given. So you select that S value and take some parameters. It is given here. So you can also, you can select, first of all, it is given here, it is given 2H0 by C. So you can select 2H0 by C value also. You can take directly from there. You note down 2H0 by C is this thing. Let us say for L by D ratio of 1, S value is 1.33. So for that, we'll select this value. Okay, 2H0 by C value, we'll write this value. Then we'll write this phi value. We can write mu into D by C value. So these three values you would note down. Okay, and after writing this value, you will see that here we are getting mu into D by C, correct? So D by C already you know that, and then you can, and this mu into D by C value is given here, so you can calculate mu from there, correct? After that, calculate the heat generated by using this formula, mu into W into V, and after that heat dissipated. Then heat to be taken out by artificial cooling, and after that you can finally calculate the artificial cooling required, quantity of artificial cooling required per minute or per second or per hour. You can calculate that. So this is the complete analysis part of the journal bearing. So here your third unit is completed, and again we'll meet in next lecture, in next unit, fourth unit. So by that time, be safe, stay safe. Thank you.